Hi, my beautiful friend Randa. I want to say welcome back, but you haven't been on this side. I've been on your side.
Yes, that's true.
So it's funny, but welcome to Revitalize Womanhood finally. I'm so excited to have you here.
Thank you. I'm so honored that you invited me. Thank you.
I could not love your wallpaper behind you anymore.
Thank you.
It's so good.
Thank you.
Okay, so Randa set me up perfectly, and I don't know if you heard me say in Kira's episode, but my monthly topic for my community is, of course, because it's Women in History Month, and the theme this year they chose was the women who tell our stories. Mm-hmm. And I had already done my whole monthly topic around it, whatever. And then all of a sudden you were like, my book is out, a compilation of these 15 women telling their stories. And I'm like, what? Boom. You're coming. You're going to be on here. And then Kira, publishing house, helping women tell their stories. I'm like, oh my gosh, the stars, like, seriously, just aligned perfectly for this.
Yeah. Thank you. And the compilation book, the collaboration book, like, Kira's in this book with me. And it's so powerful when we tell our stories. And the reason I wanted to do this collaboration book was because I know for me, I learn about myself when I listen to other people's stories. I can read all the self-help books. My brain does not function with do A, B, C, D. But if you give me your story and you tell me what you did and your experience, I'm like, oh, I can do that. And that was the whole premise of why I wanted to do a collaboration book.
The perspectives, the different perspectives. Mm-hmm. And they're beautiful, beautiful, very different perspectives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So so take me back to how this first started, because you are, I have told my listeners, but you are a three-time book author.
Almost.
It's coming.
That's not true. I was in Kira's first collaboration book. So I guess that technically I am a three-book author. But me as a head author, two, three coming. The third is coming this year.
It's coming this year. So that's, yeah. I'm ahead of you. I'm manifesting that it's already done. So it's three time. Okay. Four now. Okay.
Yes.
Four.
Yeah. Yes.
All Absolutely. The wins. We're going to celebrate all the wins.
Thank you.
So with this, because it is what we want to share right now, this healing through broken relationships, what was it that struck you to finally say, I need to do this and these other women need to do this with me?
Okay, so this goes back to like the hardest time of my life. My husband and I separated. We were pregnant with our fifth child. We have five kids. Pregnant with my fifth child, and we decided we needed to separate and eventually divorce. We were divorced for about 3 years, and then we remarried. So I've remarried my husband twice, or I've married him twice. And about 6 months after we were remarried, I had this really strong impression and a push from a friend who was also in this collaboration book with me to write a book about my story. And so fast forward like 8 years, I still haven't written this book about my divorce remarriage story, healing through a broken relationship. And I wrote my children's book first. I wrote out most of this remarriage book, and I decided I was going to wait to publish it until my husband could write his side, because I believe there are two sides to every story. Very rarely is it all one person's fault. Are there instances? Yes, but very rarely. And so I had this idea of doing a collaboration with women that had healed through their broken relationships of divorce and remarriage. And what happened was I realized I actually wanted this book to be about diverse relationships. And I wanted it to just cover a gamut of those things. And so I just put a call out. Hey, have you been in a broken relationship, healed from it, and found resiliency. Maybe it's not resolved, but you were resilient through healing that broken relationship yourself. And so that's basically how it happened. Kira is like, yes, let's do this. And like 6 months later, here it is, 17 authors. And three are men, one is my husband. And we actually don't talk about our divorce and remarriage in this book at all because we are writing that book separately. So that's
I love that you said resilience and not just a finalization of it, because it's not, this isn't a fairy tale. This isn't a Disney movie. This isn't like, it doesn't get wrapped up. Life doesn't always get wrapped up in this perfectly with a ribbon on it. Here you go. It's done. Right.
Yeah.
So this is the book. Anybody that's looking on YouTube, Healing Through Broken Relationships. And it is beautiful and beautifully written. And your story, friend. Okay, we are going to dive into this. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Because it is beautiful. And it's so hard for me to read it because my heart just hurts for you, because I see you and I see this beautiful, vibrant, like the glowing energy around you type person, right? That you just bring so much joy, and that you had so much pain inside you while this was happening. So will you please, I know I didn't really introduce you to my, I mean, I introduced you in your intro, but I would actually love for you to introduce yourself, because I love to hear how people introduce themselves.
Thank you. Okay. My name is Randa Stratton Dutcher. I am a mother of five. I've been married to my high school sweetheart and husband twice. And I'm a three-time author, almost four. I am the host of the Going Dutch podcast. And I'm an intuitive life coach, where I help women discover and use their gifts, because I believe our gifts are inherent. And when we dive into those and are rooted deeply in them, our purpose does come through. What else? I'm a cowgirl. My favorite horse is a buckskin, and I love peanut butter, and I take my pillow everywhere.
I love that. I love that. And can we please stop for a minute and let everyone know that your voice is phenomenal. And she has now sang. Yes, she's a singer. She sang at the Phoenix Suns game, the national anthem, and has sang at multiple rodeos, the national anthem. And I am so honored that I've gotten to hear how beautiful your voice is, especially when you were starting our podcast on your podcast, our episode together. So thank you for that introduction. I love that. I really do. I love it. Because I've said it, oh my gosh, you guys, I'm sorry, I say it all the time, but you can read someone's bio, right? You can Google people, you can go and see what other people say about them, but it's really interesting, because an introduction, when you introduce yourself, it's kind of like the most important things to you, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Those are the things that you want to share first. So I love that. Thank you. So I want to talk, we are going to dive into this, folks, because it's a beautiful, beautiful story. And you talk about living with, struggling through, surviving. I'm using these words intentionally, dysmorphia. And that led to suicidal ideation.
Yeah.
So will you just take us back to wherever you want to start in that story?
So there are some things that I believe that we inherit through our DNA, RNA, through our genetics, from parents, from aunts and uncles, from our nurturing situations of growing up. And what I perceived and what I felt was, my body is not okay. My body is not good. There's something wrong with me. And that kind of stems from my parents. Got pregnant in high school. They lived in a very small Christian community, and there was a lot of shame around them getting pregnant with me. And what I talk about in the book is, when I was born, it was like, oh, here's this beautiful baby, and now everything's okay, and they got married, and so, okay, everything's fine now. But while they were pregnant with me, there was just all the shame, and I also believe that in utero, babies experience what parents are experiencing. And I know this because when I went through my divorce, my daughter experienced a lot of trauma that manifests now in her daily life, as well as a study that was done on children that were in utero or born around 9/11 and how they had similar struggles to what my daughter struggle with now. So that's where I get my belief of the shame that was around my parents being pregnant with me. I took that on. And I believe that through my birth and in utero in the womb, that I took on this shame, this body shame of I shouldn't be here. There's something wrong. And then also just cultural markers of I'm short, petite, but I'm curvy. And so a lot of frustration that I couldn't be tall and thin. I don't have long, skinny legs. I have boobs and butt and a tiny waist. But I didn't accept that probably until the last year, year and a half, to be honest. And when you live in this world of there's something wrong here all the time, it's very easy. It was very easy for me to go to, well, then why am I even living? Maybe I shouldn't have even been born. There was all this shame and they shouldn't, my parents shouldn't have gotten pregnant with me. Then maybe I shouldn't have even been born. And so in some sense, there was a habit that was formed of when something went wrong out here, then I would internalize and say, okay, there's something wrong here and I shouldn't be living. Now, I want to say that I've never attempted suicide, but it is where my brain goes to. It is a neural pathway that over and over, because of those thoughts, it just is habitual to go there. And because I've had so many tools and trainings now, and I'm cognizant and mature, I can look at it and say, okay, that's not a true thought, and I'm not going to do anything about it. I would even say I'm a very lazy suicide ideation person, because if I went through all of the scenarios that I could, to accomplish that, there's nothing that I want to do because I don't love physical pain. So, does that answer your question?
Absolutely. That's okay. No, you didn't. It was great.
What I want to know more about is, because I think all of us go through something similar to that in high school, in junior high school, in that time in our lives where we're going from being a child to being a woman, right? I think all girls to women, whatever you want to call us, young ladies, go through a kind of body image, body shaming, unfortunately, right? I don't think I've ever had the privilege of knowing anyone who hasn't.
Yeah.
And so what I'm wondering is what happens then for, because we all still kind of, I mean, at some level, it's like saying, I don't care what people think. At some level, we all still care what people think. I mean, I don't leave my house without mascara, right? I mean, there is a level at which I do absolutely not want to cross, right?
Yeah.
But you can not care what people think and function and be a better person for it. But at some level, right? So at some level, we all have those things about us that is a daily practice to not focus on, right? To not, you know, get lost in like, oh, I don't like my nose, or oh, I don't like my butt, or oh, I don't like, you know, whatever it is, right?
Yeah.
So at what point do you feel like some of us get past what you continue to struggle with, right?
Okay, so what I would say to that is I'm an experiential person. So I'm going to use experience as my teacher. When I am living in and expressing my gifts it doesn't matter what my body looks like. It doesn't matter how many calories I've eaten today. It doesn't matter that I'm a different number on the scale today than I was yesterday. It only matters that I feel connected to my gifts and ultimately connected to my higher power, God, whatever you want to call it. And when I am deep in that, literally nothing else matters. It doesn't matter that there's 10 million life coaches now. It doesn't matter that there's 10 million singers out there. It doesn't matter that I haven't gotten to sing at the NFR yet. Like, none of that matters because I am in the present when I'm using my gifts. And so that has been the tether to dispel the, I'll say, the myth that my body isn't good enough, or focusing or obsessing on, I need to be this size, look this way, any of those things. Does that make sense?
It does. I'm just trying to think of what practices have you come into that help you realize that, right? That help you stay in the present, that help you realize your gifts. Because, hang on, this is kind of a two-part, because we know that the reason that women don't feel like they have purpose is because they are not using those gifts that they were born with, that they were blessed with, that they were given, right? From birth. Yeah. I talk about this so much in my community that I know for a fact we have gifts at birth when we're born, because guess what? I have three beautiful boys that have amazing little personalities, could not be more different. Each of them amazing in their own perfect way, right? But somewhere along the line, those perfect little personalities start to feel like they're not good enough, or start to feel like they need to compare themselves to someone else, or start to feel like they need to be like someone else. They start thinking that their worth is somewhere external, right?
Right.
So we bury down our gifts. We bury these down. So instead of showing up as outgoing Gina, I will meet anybody. I am this person that wants to connect all these women. I would maybe just clean vacation rentals, right? Something that I just can isolate. I can go into myself and do something by myself that's not a community setting, right? So that in that way, I'm, you know, so what practices have you found for yourself that have helped you unbury these gifts that you've kind of, society has helped you hide?
This is exactly what I help women through in my intuitive coaching. Because our gifts get muddled down and covered up. Like you said, it's super easy to just go clean a rental. Like, that is something you know you can do. Put in your headphones. You can do that all day. And at the end of the day, you feel purposeful because you accomplished something. But it doesn't necessarily mean that you feel fulfilled. I am a baker. I can go make cinnamon rolls all the day long. And at the end of the day, I'm exhausted. I feel like I did something. And I have something to prove it, and I can eat, and everyone can enjoy, but it didn't fulfill me in here. It didn't fulfill my spirit. It didn't fulfill me completely. And what happens is we cover up our gifts, like you said, because we feel like our worth is tied to what we can do and accomplish, or how much money we can make, or the things people can see, the tangible. But your gifts aren't always the tangible. I can go sing anywhere, the national anthem or a hymn or a song. If I sing just the words, that is accomplishing something. But if I connect to the words and then connect to you and you connect to the words, that is fulfilling. So when we can uncover the muck and the mire and the trauma, or the idea that our gifts aren't real, or we can't use them, or I don't have any, and we clear all of that off, then that gift bubbles up. And then we can use them. And the definition of purpose actually is like motivation, movement, intention. But our gifts are not necessarily motivation. So I believe that purpose and gifts can be tied together, but we have to have we have to figure out what our gift is first. We have to remember what that is. And I do, like you, believe that we each have inherent gifts. If you're a scriptorian, we know in the scriptures that there are lots of spiritual gifts. And it says that Christ is the body of all gifts, and that we each can be a hand or a foot or a head. But it is up to spirituality to be the whole of those gifts. We can't have a monopoly on all of them. It is up to us to use our specific gifts for whoever needs those.
That was beautiful. Dropping scripture up in here. That was so pretty. Thank you for saying that and sharing that. I don't know if you, again, I have the hardest time when people come onto my show. I'm like, I have like very limited boundaries. I mean, like, I haven't really found all of them yet. Right. When I find them, I know that I'm strong enough to say that's a boundary and I don't cross it. But just so if I do, let me know. But because I know this is very personal things, but you have shared in your book, you talk about a podcast episode where you were choosing to live. Mm-hmm. Will you share with me the experiences that were going on in that time?
Yes. So I had an experience. I grew up LDS. I still am LDS. And I had an experience that was both, I'm going to use the word expansive, because if anybody listened to Kira's podcast, she talks about expansion. It was incredibly expansive and it was incredibly traumatic all at the same time. I felt incredibly powerful in this experience and I felt immense shame and guilt. And I gravitated towards the shame and guilt, and I gravitated to it for about 2 years. And at the end of that 2 years, I was like ready to take my life. And Kira's mom actually reached out to me and she said, "How are you doing? Because we're friends." And I said, "Actually, I'm not good. I'm not good at all." And I started going back to counseling and talked to Kira's mom. And through all of it, I realized that shame and guilt actually was not what I needed to gravitate towards. And that is exactly what darkness wanted me to gravitate towards, because it shuts me down. I stopped singing. I stopped performing. I stopped writing. I stopped journaling. I stopped doing all the things that I know to do, all the grounding exercises. And ultimately just like felt death. And if you look, I don't know what the chart is called, the energy chart that they measure. And it says like emotions and the amount of energy that they have tied to those emotions. Shame is the closest to death. And so at some point I had to choose to live and move into the expansion. And about that time, I joined Kira's author group, Mastermind, and I started writing my book about divorce and remarriage. And that pulled me out using those gifts, using music, pulled me out of that, and I chose to live.
I feel like women isolate in the majority. Mm-hmm. I mean, again, I am pretty familiar with women. I mean, mm-hmm. I have a lot of sisters, a lot of aunts, a lot of cousins, and now this community. I mean, lots of friends. I just love getting to know women. So through my life, I feel like I kind of have a perspective on this. And in the majority of cases, women isolate when something goes wrong, when they feel shame or guilt or right, or they feel like they're not. I love the last word you used in your book. You had the combined weight of shame, guilt, and expectations.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That is a very, very significant and very powerful word that maybe people don't think of as far as shame and guilt being, because those do for me think, I'm like, I don't feel shame, I don't feel guilt, but I always feel expectations and I feel them mm-hmm. for myself. I compare with my, against myself, right? I'm in competition mm-hmm. with myself at least, you know, but it's, women isolate when we feel these things, when we feel like we have a fight with our husband or we have, we've gone too far with our kids or whatever situation, women isolate. And without fail, every single one of these specific experiences that I'm thinking of in my head, when they had the courage to reach out and ask for help, or reach out and like a lifeline almost, right? Just here's my last chance of getting out of this dark place, and not that dramatic, but really it feels that way when you're isolating yourself. It does feel that way. So this last lifeline thrown to somebody, once if they get the right person that can pull them out and bring them back out into community and sharing and openness and being raw and being vulnerable, it's like a night and day difference. It is literally like a light switch being turned back on, right? Yeah. Women are, they need that. They need that because I feel like in those moments, you're allowing your actual gifts. Like you said, you started writing again. You're allowing your actual gifts to come out because you want them to be seen by this one person that you've thrown this lifeline to, right?
Yeah.
And then what happens? You've thrown it to that right person and they're like, oh, you're amazing. Oh, you're so strong. You are beautiful. You are just energy in my life, right? You start getting all of these things that you really needed. So it's really, really hard for me to watch when women do these things, when they ghost you or when they go dark or when they isolate, because what they needed. And a lot of times I will have conversations with those women and they're it's like going for coffee with your best girlfriend, right? Mm-hmm. You've just been feeling in a funk, right? And then you go and you go to like a good yoga class or you go have a good lunch. And afterwards, what do you feel?
Free.
Energy, right? Mm-hmm. Just you feel like you could conquer the world, right? You just feel like that was so refreshing. You just lit me up. I feel so happy. I can go take on the rest of my life, right? You know, and of course they come in spurts, but if you have the tools and you have the mental strength to realize that that's where it's happening.
Yeah.
So you don't want to be over here. You want to focus on being over here because that's where your gifts are going to come out more, right?
Yeah. And also what I would say to that is, if you're over here in the shame, isolation, whatever, call it the shame game. If you're over in the shame game, don't make yourself wrong for being in the shame game, because then that just adds more shame to the shame game. Just be like, okay, this is where I'm at right now. And I actually, out of that, created a what I call a litmus test or a happy tracker. And I have a list of things that make me happy, gifts that I want to use. And I require of myself that I do 2 to 5 of these things a day, whether it's baking, singing, riding my horse, going for a walk, walking my dogs, or having a conversation with a friend or recording a podcast. Any of those things, I just require 2. And that is like, that can pull me out of that shame game. Okay, I'm accomplishing something. And I'm doing something that pulls me out of that because it's tied to my gifts.
I'm adding that to my habit tracker. Pull me, you know, something like you're saying, exactly. Something, what is it that just lights your fire? Sit down and really think about it. I mean, if it's knitting, if it's baking, if it's what just lights your fire. I had a guest on and it was a very powerful conversation. And she says, I said that. I said, how do you find what you're passionate about? And she gave a very good example. She says, which it won't be aired until later, until April, but she says, if you could go to dinner with some friends, imagine you're there at dinner with some friends and you could just talk and 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 talk about one thing, just this specific thing. It just lights your fire. It just, your eyes light up. Everything about you just is just beaming from what you're talking about. You're so excited about it, right? And at the end of that 4-hour dinner of you just talking and talking and talking and talking, you're jazzed, right? Like, because you said you could bake, you could be in the kitchen baking and you love it. But at the end of the day, you're tired. Probably your back hurts, your feet mm-hmm. hurt. You know, you're just like, oh, and you kind of just want to fall into bed. Whereas when you find your passion, when you find your calling and you are living in it, your gifts are coming out, you are vibrating with it. You could do it all day long and still keep going.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah, you got to raise the vibration.
Yeah, I love that. Raise the vibration. Yeah. Okay. So because you are so perfectly aligned with my topic this month and you have so many beautiful books, like this episode is just a beautiful outline of these books. Because this adorable book that you sent to me for my kids and I read it to them that night, and it is, if you're looking on the YouTube, you have a gift, Shine Bright. And it is beautiful. I just sat there and just loved it because especially it spoke to them perfectly. They are at this perfect age of where little Randa is. And it's talking about everybody has their special gift, right? And mm-hmm. so-and-so might have this gift and so-and-so might have this gift and so-and-so, yeah. right? And I hope I do a good job in encouraging those gifts. It's hard for moms. It is, because if you're intentional about it, you will see. And since I've been doing this, I've become very intentional about seeing that I'm trying to maybe shape them into a little person, into a little box of what I think that they should be, right? Mm-hmm. Like behave, please don't make noise, please, you know, like
yeah.
It's so yeah. silly. It's so hard. When I should be saying, Hayes, you are so loud, and he never stops talking. This kid never, never. He wants to tell you facts about bugs. He wants to tell you facts yeah. about animals. He wants to tell yeah. you about his day at school. I mean, whew. But that's amazing.
Yes.
It is so beautiful. He is like yes. a product of me and Rick. I mean, it is, hello. But it is hard as moms because we have so many other things and we are so overwhelmed. So by the time their beautiful little gifts are showing, mm-hmm. we're just like, can you just go in the back room and just keep that to yourself, please? You know?
Yeah. Yeah. That it is hard because I think you and I probably grew up similarly in that there was a lot of expectation in how you act. And so I've heaped that upon my kids, and it's not gone well with my children. Like, you will look people in the eye, you will shake hands, you will say, hi, how are you? Which I believe are just good fundamentals. But I have a child that's extremely shy, and it is painful for her to talk to a stranger. It's extremely painful. And so I have to preface it differently with her than I did everybody else, and intentionally use her gifts to say, you have these gifts. And it's really important that we acknowledge other people that they're seen. And so that, I don't know if you were asking me a question or not, but that's kind of why I wrote this book, is because I want everyone to know that there are hundreds of gifts, hundreds. One of my very best friends, she can't sing. She's not musical at all, but she is the happiest person I've ever met and gives the best hugs. And one day she said, Randa, I don't have any gifts. And I was like, bull crap, because you give the best hugs. And anytime I'm feeling down, I know I can call you and you will laugh at me and make me feel better within 5 seconds. That is a true gift that I do not have. I don't have that gift. And she said, oh my gosh, you're right. You're right. I have the gift of happiness. I'm always happy. And I want kids, I want adults to feel that way too, that you don't have to be musical. You don't have to be organized. You don't have to have all of the typical gifts that we all grew up with. You don't have to be athletic. You can be really good at cleaning blinds. You can be really good at sifting through something. You can be really good at anything. But finding that gift, you can be good at making something out of toothpicks or Legos or whatever. And so finding your gifts and realizing that you probably have at least 10 gifts you don't even know. And I made a list of about 150 at the end of my children's book that kids or adults can circle. Oh, I do have that gift. Oh, I have that opportunity and I can do that. And when you realize that you are gifted, that starts to raise the vibration.
I love it. Absolutely. Totally agree. My favorite thing, maybe I'll write a kid's book. I love having a magic mirror. I have a mirror that I can show, put in front of your face, and you will see yourself the way that I see you. Mm. Right?
Yes.
Copyright, trademark.
Yes.
But you know, it's been so clear to me in starting this and these women that I meet, and they don't feel that way. They don't feel like this, you know, and you too, I'm sure you meet these same women, you know, and it's like, why, how can I help you? How can I help you see what I'm seeing? And that is it's my journey. That's my journey. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm working with. But, oh, yeah. I love it. I love that book. It was so beautiful. Thank you for sending that to my boys. I really appreciate
that.
Oh,
you're welcome. I'm glad you enjoyed it. Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to send that. And so, yes, trademark and write that book.
Yeah, I will. That would be a really cute kid's book. That would be adorable. Mm-hmm. I should talk to Kira. I was talking to Kira and I'm like, just by the way, she had to get off because I didn't know she had a hard stop, which I probably should have asked her before we started, but she was going to get her braces off. And I'm like, and so she's like, I got a hard stop coming up. And I'm like, oh, criminy. Okay, we've got blah, 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 you know. And at the end, I'm like, by the way, I wrote my book. You helped me channel my book. So we'll have to talk to her again later. But yeah. I want to discuss, and however much you want to give yet, but let's start talking. Let's start jazzing up the new release of this coming soon, Gifts of Divorce, with you and Aaron, your husband. And I just listened to, I picked at random. I don't even know that I knew it was the one with you and him. Something about it I just picked because I was getting ready for this. So I like to listen to an episode or something. And it was your episode with him. And it was adorable. It was absolutely adorable the way you gush on each other. And I'm just like, oh my goodness, you too. Oh,
so thank you.
It wasn't always that way.
No. And it's not always that way either.
No,
it is it's a roller coaster. And that's what I tell newlyweds. Anytime anyone's getting married, I'm like, enjoy the roller coaster because there's going to be highs and lows. There's going to be moments when you want your picture taken or you're like wanting to be off the ride, and moments where you want to be in the front and where you want to be in the back. Marriage is such a roller coaster. Enjoy the ride because just like a muscle has to be broken down to get stronger, marriages have to have the same. And we've had a lot of breakdown. I don't know if all marriages have the same amount of breakdown and trauma, but we've had a lot. And my husband is a fighter, and he is an endurer, and he will endure so much when he feels like it is worth it. And he is also like the biggest lover. He has the most giant heart. And when we first got married, we didn't know what love languages were. And his biggest complaint to me was, I don't feel supported. I don't feel supported. And in my mind, what support meant was, I'm going to cook and clean. I'm going to have babies. I'm going to take care of those babies. And that's my job. And so you can go to work. I'm going to stay home. I'm totally supporting you. You get to work all the hours you want. But what we didn't realize, either of us, was support meant his love languages, which were words of affirmation, physical touch, mostly those two. And because words of affirmation are not mine. Like, I can go to work all day, do something all day. I don't need to hear from you. I don't need you to tell me how great of a job I'm doing. I don't need to hear that I'm beautiful. Like, sometimes it's too much. Just tell me you love me. Show me, because I'm a quality time and gifts person. Show me. And so I was showing him. And so we did not understand those things. And we had some infidelity on both of our parts, me emotionally, him physically and emotionally. And eventually it broke us and we burned everything to the ground. And because of that opportunity to be solo, we both realized what we missed and were able to come back together. And we've had a lot of counseling. We still do counseling. We still are working through things sometimes because everybody has triggers. And we were able to reconcile and come back together. And so that book, this book is about how it happened and how we got back together and how it's going now. And people think, oh, you got remarried, it was all butterflies and rainbows. No, it wasn't. It was 9 months of still hell. Because I hardly slept in the same bed for about the first 9 months of our remarriage because I was still working through things, but I knew and had a really strong pull on my heart that I wanted to be with my children's father. And I felt like, okay, we can make a go of this again. And we set some parameters in place and we were able to work through that. And like I said, triggers still come up. We're still working through things sometimes. But we are so much better because we choose in every day. We choose to risk. And I don't believe, at some point, maybe we'll trust each other again, but we don't choose to say, I trust you. We choose to say, I choose to risk with you again. I choose to risk my heart again. There was a really great TED Talk on addiction and how addicts really crave connection. And if someone's going towards addictions, what they really need is that connection. And so we also have reframed that. Okay, you're struggling or I'm struggling. What I really need is connection. And it's hard, so hard, when you're hurt or triggered or you're upset to say, okay, I'm going to connect with you when I'm really, really ticked off. But that ultimately is like the key.
What's an example of connecting, like in a moment like that, when you've just really hurt the other person or they've really hurt you, or, you know, you're just raw and like, get away from me. I want nothing to do with you. Right. In those mm-hmm. moments, we all yeah. know those moments. What's an example of
connection? Mm-hmm. Well, an easy go-to as a married couple is sex. That's like a super easy. I don't know if I can say that on your show.
Yes, absolutely. Sex.
Yeah. So that's an easy go-to. It resets the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system.
So oh my gosh. Easy. Can you imagine that though? I can't even imagine that. Yeah. I can't imagine. Yeah, we're going to, but actually, no, actually our first baby was conceived in anger. So we hadn't been fighting. We hadn't been doing anything wrong, but then mm-hmm. because he wouldn't come and acknowledge that my temperature was just right, you know, yeah. it was like, this is happening. So yes, perspective. Thank you.
Yeah.
And I didn't even necessarily, of course, when you say connecting, I thought of sex, but I wondered if you were supposed to do that, if that's as far as you're supposed to go, or if it's supposed to be just like, hey, I'm mad at you. I love you. We are safe, but I can't be around you right now. I mean, mm-hmm. and that would be a form of it, but.
Mm-hmm. So I would say I'm not a therapist, so mm-hmm. I don't know if that's right or wrong.
In that your is what experience.
Works. That is what works for us. Mm-hmm. That's an easy go-to. But also a deep connection is breathing in each other's space and being intimate without sex. And what that looks like, this is super vulnerable and personal, but we sit together. My hand goes on his heart and his hand goes on my heart. And you just breathe and look into each other's eyes for 13 seconds. And that also, you will feel a shift within 13 seconds of connection and love. It's super woo-woo. Not every man, I think, is open to that, but that is also a good one.
I love that.
And then clearing the air, being able to say everything you need to say without fear of judgment or anger. Being able to say, I'm struggling with XYZ. Like, I could literally tell Aaron my deepest, darkest secrets, and there is zero judgment. He might feel some fear, because if you've read my chapter in the collaboration book, there can be some fear attached to that. Okay, is this where she's going? Is this going to happen? But we have learned that we can say anything, absolutely anything to each other without judgment, and then ask questions. And that is a connecting practice also, because you can feel compassion for someone without judgment or expectation.
That's a great one. I'm writing it down.
And what I would, there's also a caveat to that. You have to, or something that I do, is I have to tell myself, this is not about me. You can have someone that's an addict, that's working in addiction, and also love me. I can be addicted to my things and still love my husband. I can experience suicide ideation and still love my kids, still receive inspirational messages, still record a podcast, still write a book. I can do all of those things and still experience darkness. So I don't believe that we are creatures of and or, and we have to be able to say whatever our spouse is saying or a partner or someone is saying to us is not about us. It's not personal.
I just actually had a text from one of my gals, and she said, today I'm working on realizing that my teenager is not having all of these big emotions at me. He's having all of these big emotions because he's expressing his independence, right? He's figuring out his, what we just talked about. He's figuring out how to be his own person. And I said, yeah, absolutely. You, easy to say, have to respect that this is his reality right now. And I had a mindset coach on here that she said, it's especially when it comes from our kids and they're saying these things that are hurtful, but it's, you have to acknowledge that that is their reality. It's not my reality. I can't force my reality on someone else. So yeah, absolutely. That's beautiful. I actually, it's so funny because my notes from what I just wanted to talk to you, you went through all of them. I picked out that, Aaron had said to you, just give me even a little bit of acknowledgement and I can carry the world, right? He wanted scraps and for that, he could carry the world for you. And if not, what's the point? And then I put that you put, how am I not supporting you? How am I not? Because that is absolutely the tip of the iceberg, isn't it? Because you are thinking that you're doing all of these things. He is thinking that he's doing all of these things. You're not communicating that even though we are doing all of these amazing things, it's not what the other person needs. And just because I feel like this is what I would need, it's not what you need. And I challenged my Instagramosphere, you know, I sent a message out the first of this week that was a challenge saying, I don't care what your love language is, that man that you are married to and you want him to be a strong, capable, right? You want him to be this amazing person for you. And maybe you want him to do these amazing things for you too, but it starts with you, right? It starts with you. You can't like just be like, you need to do this for me. It starts with you. So my challenge was throughout the next week forever. I mean, hello, it's a practice, right? Everything we do, this is, I preach, this is the revitalized lifestyle. It's not a quick fix. It's not, okay, I did my 90-day goal. I'm done now. It's a lifestyle. It's forever. Yeah. So this week in particularly, go out of your way to be intentional about flirting, about saying thanks for something, about, honey, you did such a good job with this, or whatever, you know, and just see what happens with that. Actually, Rick texted me back. It was so funny. Because I say these things because I'm trying to practice things, you know, it's most of everything I do, say, type, write, whatever, my content is because it's coming from such a personal place in my life that I feel like there's gotta be other people that need to hear this right now, right? Yeah. And he texted me back and it said, oh, it was so funny. Where is it? Oh my gosh. You know, with your husband text too, it's like 50 in a day.
Right.
But it was basically along the lines of, gosh, this new to-do list of yours is really, really amazing for my self-esteem or something. Because he knows, he sees that I'm doing it. He knows. Yeah. He's reading my Instagram post going, okay, she's challenged herself to leave me notes and text me and flirt with me, you know?
Yeah.
And he's like, I'm really loving this challenge you're in. And I'm like, even though he knows that's what I'm doing, it doesn't take away from the fact that I'm doing it, right? He's still getting the goodness of it.
Yes.
And that's what I loved that part about that. And then also, I will say, Aaron, he's a smart boy. He's super smart. He said, and this, I'm sorry, I need to let you talk. He says, look at this as coaching, not counseling. Just like Michael Jordan, Tiger Woods, they needed coaching, right? Because men are so resistant to counseling. Yeah. Rick has said it so many times. I'm like, we need to go to counseling. We need a therapist. We need whatever, whatever. Because I don't believe in all hell's broken loose. This is the very last straw. And if this doesn't work, we're done, right? I believe in... Yeah. It's a practice, right? So if we can get the tools to start communicating better, why wouldn't we do this before the SS trimmer goes down, right? So, and he's always said he's finally starting to come around to saying things like, I don't know why I just have such a block when it comes to that. I don't know why, but I think that's such a common thing for men to think of it that way.
Well, I think in some form, at some point, they've tied counseling to something's wrong and I can't fix it. And if you have a fix it Felix type of husband, I have a fix it Felix. Like, you come in with any problem, he's like, okay, I'm right here, I'm going to fix it for you. And if they can't fix it and they're relying on someone else, it's like, okay, well, that's really weak. That means I'm weak. And that's not true. Michael Jordan wasn't weak. Tiger Woods isn't weak. Any football player, anybody, any singer. I've had thousands of hours of singing lessons, college and after college, and I still go to YouTube and look at singing lessons. So if you want to be better at something, why wouldn't you want coaching for your vital relationship? Like, your number one relationship that ebbs and flows into everything else that you do.
100%.
Yeah. And I would say I'm not great at acknowledging. I have calendar reminders every day throughout my day. Acknowledge your husband, or even just a statement about him to remind me, okay, this is my moment. And I have an Android, so I can schedule my texts. He knows that I have these calendar reminders, but I'll schedule my texts. And he loves selfies. So I will batch when I'm feeling good, I'll batch selfies. And like, then I'll send like one a day. Like, he wants to know if I'm in the car or at the hay barn or riding my horse or singing or in the sauna or in the cold plunge. Like, he wants to know what I'm doing. Like, that is his love language. And then also some acknowledgement. And that's really hard for me to do. But I've had to learn and practice. This is not about me. This is about him. And I've even come to the conclusion that I no longer blame him or feel victimized by his actions. When we went through our divorce, he if you've listened to our podcast, there was infidelity. There was another woman. And I don't, his choices are his choices. I'm not saying that they're not. But I don't blame him because I wasn't doing any of the things to make him feel loved and supported. And I didn't know. So I pushed him into a corner. Where's he supposed to go? He starts looking for external validation, external love and connection. And the person that finally gave that. So I don't even blame him anymore. I'm like, I realize that was my fault.
Wow. That's an amazing journey you've been on, because to get to that place takes a lot of acknowledgement, a lot. Yeah.
And it sucks to be responsible for your own trauma. It really,
yeah,
really sucks to be like, okay, this was my responsibility. He had his, and I'm not taking that away from him. Please, audience, don't think that I'm saying anything he did was like, he was right in what he chose to do. But I was also very wrong.
It takes two, right? It takes two to make a marriage. It takes two to break a marriage.
Yeah.
In most cases.
In most cases.
Yeah. I'd love that. You get onto one of these and it airs and you get that one person that's like, well, and you're like, yes, I understand. That is your scenario. This is mine.
Yeah. Thank you. There are definitely instances where it's one person.
I love it. For sure. So beautiful. So what are you working on right now? I love watching you do your cold plunge. What got you into doing that? You've been doing that ever since I first met you.
Yeah.
What got you into doing that? I mean, I know it's all the rage right now, but you were doing it before I saw everybody else doing it.
Actually, well, Aaron's been doing it a lot longer.
Has he?
But I would say physical pain is what really pushed me towards it. I struggle with some disc issues, and my dad's a doctor of physical therapy, and he cold plunges for like a very long time to assist him. And Aaron set it up in our backyard. Like, I was never one to be like, oh, I want to go use someone else's. But he set one up in our backyard. We call it our sanctuary. And then he got a sauna. And what I realized was it was really hard for me to get in there. But every time that I did, it raised my vibration and I felt like I could do anything. I can talk to anybody. I can go do a podcast. I'm confident. It burns fat. I think, I don't even know all of the scientific benefits. There are scientists that can tell you, but I'll tell you emotionally, like if I'm struggling, it brings up all your fight, flight, or freeze responses. And sometimes it's an ugly cry for a couple of minutes. Sometimes I sing through it. Sometimes I breathe through it. Sometimes I listen to singing bowls, but it is just such a powerful tool that I try and use on the daily. One, for physical reasons, and two, for emotional.
That's awesome. Wow. You're an amazing person. Do you know that?
Aww.
I sure do love you.
Thank you. Thank you, Gina.
Yes. What do you have going on now? What's going on other than getting this book out? When can we kind of expect it? Do you even know?
That is a question for Mr. Dutcher. I actually told him this morning.
Oh!
Can you come here and do a channeling on Instagram? Because we got to get this book out. It is like...
He's holding it up.
And it's feeling heavy. Well, he's got a lot on his plate. So I try not to push, but I'm like, okay. What am I working on? I have not said this out loud, even to Aaron. This morning in the sauna, I'm going to say it here. I had a really strong impression to write another book about Esther. And I don't know what that means. She is like, she's my heroine. She is amazing. And she really, if you believe in angels, I believe in angels. I believe she is one of my guardian angels. And that she pushes me and pulls me through a lot. And Kira's writing a book with Joan of Arc, and this morning it was like super, super loud. I need to write a book with Esther. And I don't know what that looks like or even what that means, but that That is my next project.
I love it. Thank you for sharing it here.
Ooh. And I'm working on getting this book, this collaboration book on Audible. But it's a lot because there's 17 authors to get everybody lined up. It's just a long game for that, sadly.
That would be hard to get everybody doing their own part on Audible. You don't think about that, because I've had Jamie Villalobos. We were actually at their house in California last year when she was... Isn't she awesome?
Yeah.
She was in the middle of recording her audio, and she's like, it is awful. She's like, it is awful. If there is any, it is awful. She says, I just get done and I start feeling like such a robot and whatever. And I'm like, what? It's going to be amazing. And I was just trying to give her the, please just remember, it's going to be so good. I need this. I need this from you. I cannot sit down and read books. I did sit down and read her book, but I also did listen to it on Audible. I'm like, please, please, please just remember the people like me out there that are running around and have to have an earbud in. And that's the only way this is going to happen. So please let that be your energy that pushes you through it. But it was really interesting to see that side of it.
Yeah. Yeah. So those are my projects. And then kids. I got a kid graduating high school this year, and he's going to serve a mission for our church. And so, like, that's...
Where's he going? That's a lot.
He hasn't gotten his call yet.
Oh, he hasn't got it yet.
Yeah. So
I can't wait to see. I can't wait to hear. All right. Where can these folks find you?
Everything is on my Linktree. You can find my music. I'm on YouTube, Amazon, iTunes, podcasts. I'm on, I think, every type of, what do you call it?
Listening app, your podcast platform. Goes.
Every platform. I'm on every platform for podcasts and music. You can find my books on Amazon. And follow me on Instagram at Perfectly Imperfect Randa. And I have my link tree is there. And that's, you can find an example of my happy tracker and print it off from my link tree if you want an example of what I use.
I'm going to go do it right when we get off. I love it. I love tools like that. I love tools, folks. But guess what? Tools are useless if you don't use them. So use them. If you print something off, make it a habit, make it a point to do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Gina, thank you so much.
You are incredible. Can I just share? I think I did when you were on my podcast, but I just want to share quickly. When we met at Unstoppable, we were there the night before it really started, and I didn't even want to go. I didn't even dress up. I took my friend Carissa. I'm like, we're going to this thing. I don't even know what this means, but you're there with Janie. And I'm like, oh my gosh, this amazing woman is wearing a white jumper. She's incredibly beautiful. And my friend knew Janie, and Janie knew you. And somehow we all ended up in a group picture. And I was like, oh my gosh, I have to know this woman. And then we talked just a little bit. We followed each other, and you listened to one of my podcasts. You are the most incredible cheerleader for those that you connect with. And I can't tell you how much that means.
Oh, don't get me crying too. Thank you. Don't get me crying too. Holy cow. That just gave me all the chilly willies. Thank you so much for that. You're such a beautiful soul. Thanks. And I really appreciate you. I really appreciate that. You don't know what you really offer to all the rest of us, because it's unbelievable and it's powerful. So keep doing it, and keep doing, putting out this beautiful work that you do, and sharing your beautiful gift. Oh my gosh. Thank you, woman.
Thank you. I love you. Thank you so much for having me on.